Another term that is found in the scriptures is effeminacy, or the effeminate. In the Old Testament, an entire host of cities was destroyed because of its practice. Sodom, Gomorrah, and the surrounding cities were burned to the ground to ashes. Their inhabitants, some of them, did escape and continued to perpetuate this lifestyle. The fall of Rome is attributed in part and degree to the immoral practice of homosexuality. And so it will never be accepted in the sight of God. It has never been accepted in the sight of God, and despite the fact that there are any number of denominations now that seem to be embracing priests and others in the ministry who have professed openly and confessed openly to practicing lesbianality and or homosexuality, it is condemned in the scripture, and particularly in the book of Romans. Those who practice homosexuality are referred to as being turned over to a reprobate mind, to dishonor themselves among themselves, and all the people say it. And so, since the question came up, and from a theological standpoint, since I'm teaching Bible class tonight, it needs to be clear that regardless of what the nominal Christian church does, I'm not talking about God's church, because the book of Timothy, Paul wrote, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. Therefore, let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. I'm not talking about those. They are secure. Turn to someone and say, they are secure. Those who are on the foundation of God, on the word of God, and base their salvation and lifestyle on the Holy Scriptures, as they are rightly divided, have nothing to be concerned about, quite frankly. But in the nominal church community, those who claim to be born-again Christians, regardless of what they do, that will have no effect on God's church. 16th chapter of St. Matthew, Jesus Christ said, upon this rock, the revelation of who he is, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail, or shall not prevail against it. So no matter how the devil infiltrates many of the nominal churches and gains access to the ministry and gains access to high places, it is clear that we are in the last days contending with spiritual wickedness in high places, the scripture says. And some of those high places unfortunately have to do with the elevations of authority in the nominal church community. But that is not our concern, once again. From a academic perspective, homosexuality can be dealt with from many measures, from many perspectives, or from many dispositions. Someone say dispositions. One of them is historically. It has been proven historically that any community, any society that embraced homosexuality as a normal lifestyle ultimately disintegrated. One of the main reasons is because in past times, in the old world, and in the ancient kingdoms of man, they did not have the medical advancements that we have today to tamper with reproduction. And so because there was no perpetuity, no reproduction among those who embraced this lifestyle, eventually there were no children born to the unions. And ultimately, when they died, this ended their acclimation. And so from a historical and ancient perspective, it has never worked. From a medical perspective, again speaking from academia, the Center for Disease Control looked this up on their website. Do your own research. They probably have wiped the slate because of the controversy. It's proven that those who engage in acts of homosexuality, particularly anal and rectal sex, are 4,000 times more likely to contract rectal cancer. And of course, they are 2,000 times more likely to have some sort of mental and psychological breakdown, such as manic depression and bipolarism and other mental and psychological disorders. They also are 2,000 times more likely to be involved in domestic violence, conflicts. And so turn to someone and say, it just won't work. And so for those who are listening in my radio audience, I'm sure I'm under your skin if you are liberal, and I want to get deep into your bloodstream and try to bleed you until you understand that homosexuality will never have any place of normalcy and or acceptance in the sight of God. Now, certainly the Obama administration has embraced it. They promote it. They are pushing for the repeal of Don't Ask and Don't Tell in the military, trying to deal with how they're going to govern those individuals who are homosexuals when they're living in the same barracks. Are they going to allow them to crawl on top of each other at night? This would be, turn to someone and say, this would be grossly disruptive to the military. And what will happen when they repeal it? They are going to trigger another level of the judgment of God. Trust me, it's coming. Every president, as I said on Sunday, has its Katrina, has its disasters to deal with. This one in the Gulf is Barack Obama's Katrina. Katrina was an act of God. This is an act of man. Now Eric Holder, the attorney general, is calling for criminal charges to be levied against BP. And this has caused a mass exodus from the petroleum stocks in the stock market, and investors are fleeing because of the controversy surrounding the confusion, because this particular group of individuals who are instrumental in drilling in the Gulf did not follow established protocol. And unfortunately, they have caused the worst natural disaster in the history of civilization. But again, we tried to tell you, man can't save us anyway. And so while we're running around following these personalities, we will find, turn to someone and say, Jesus is coming soon. In a very nice way, the Lord will be the one that settles all matters in the end. Can the church say amen? And so now, we should understand that our subject tonight is the kingdom of God. I was looking for my notes and looking for my historical research that was done on the subject I just broached as an interlude to the Bible class tonight. And then I found them sitting over here in my Bible from which I preached on Sunday morning. I also would like to announce that I have an AIS, Apostolic Information Service, DVD or CD, whatever this is. There's a host of these, a collection of these in the office. These particular, or this resource is for those who are interested in leadership. What is found in this will be given to you free as long as you're going to look at it and do something with it. Because to whom much is given, so much is required. And so now, Calvary's pulpit, where Dr. Superintendent Paul Mooney is the pastor in Indianapolis, Indiana. He's in the process of building a 5,000-seater church. And then, of course, he has an audio sermon, ministry resources, leadership training, pulpit resources, church growth, Bible college training, and an AIS file list. This is for your benefit. This will be given to those who are interested in leadership. Someone say leadership. If you're interested in this, it will be given to you free after services. If we're not looking for you to take this and put it with your collection of relics that you hold in religious esteem, so you can say you have this and have that. The problem with that is when you're given these things that are supposed to be used to be fruitful, if you are not fruitful, then you become accountable to God for lack of fruitfulness, because God does not give us anything to collect and argue.